Hello and welcome to the Brutal Iron Gym Podcast, where our goal is to cut through the BS and deliver the brutal truth about topics related to health and happiness. So today's topic is trainer education. The title is Improving Your Programming, and we're going to cover the small details today. So one of the fun aspects of my job is I get to work with other personal counselors. Personal trainers. So I just got done training a client who was a counselor. So that was probably still stuck in my brain there. But I work with the personal trainers, and I do a lot of programming for the trainers themselves. So they have physical goals, nutrition-related goals, things they want to accomplish, whether it's strength sports, aesthetic sports, either learning physical therapy, rehab stuff, anything, whatever their goals are, I get to work with them. And I super duper enjoy it because often personal trainers are super dedicated. They're going to do anything I tell them to do. It's their passion. It's their drive. So they are very fun to work with. And then also with those trainers that I work with, and also with people who just contact me via the podcast or other reasons, we do other kind of like assistance kind of like services for personal trainers. So that's one of the reasons why we have this personal trainer, trainer education podcast as a regular subject. So it's one of the four things we cover all the time, is because I do work with so many personal trainers, and we always get into conversations. There's always needs, there's always information that they request, and I don't think there's really great resources for trainers out there. So I wanted to be one. And then what I do with some of the trainers as well is we'll either do consultations. People want kind of information about how to do something we're going to talk about today, is like write really good programming. Maybe they want to talk about specific issues they're having with business development or business promotion, stuff like that. So we do consultations. I do ghost writing, so I help write programs for trainers where I don't get the recognition for it. It's their client. They're just having a client who's difficult or has needs, or there's something that they can't quite do on their own yet. So they'll ask for advice or information or me to help. So I'll write the programming myself, and then they give it to the client as it's their work. I like that in the sense, like people have asked me before, don't I feel bad about, or don't I have any issues with my work being passed off as someone else's? Not really, because the whole goal is somebody's getting helped. So I don't really care. If somebody's getting healthier and happier from it, whatever. So I don't care if I get recognition or not. So the trainer and I will do like ghostwriting stuff. And all of that leads to different discussions. And a recent discussion I had with somebody I thought was interesting. And it prompted the idea of making kind of like a series of improving your programming and starting with something like the small details. So recently a trainer that I helped with educational aspects sent me a program that they wrote for a client of theirs. And within the program, they paired dumbbell 15-degree incline chest presses. Okay, so give me a second to kind of picture that in your head. So I talk pretty fast sometimes, so I want to kind of go slow enough that this all makes sense. So they have dumbbell presses at a 15-degree incline. And they paired that with a one-arm dumbbell row, but the variation of the person having their hand and knee on the bench. So there's actually a lot of variations of dumbbell rows. So we even have a video on our YouTube channel. If you go to Brutal Iron Gym on YouTube, and you can even search Brutal Iron Gym dumbbell rows, and you'll see a couple variations we have just in a single video. But there's a lot more than just we have there. It's like you can have, a flat bench where your hand and knee is on the bench, your other leg, the foot is on the ground for stabilization, and the other arm is kind of doing the dumbbell row. You also have dumbbell rows with both feet on the ground, but you have a hand on a bench for like low back support. You can do that with your feet kind of side by side, or you can do it with your feet open. The feet open allows a lot more like rotational torque, so usually people are stronger in that position, whereas the feet narrowed together limits rotational torque, so it's a little bit of a weaker position, but it's more isolative of the back. You can also do different pull motions. So somebody can pull back in an arch towards their hip to get the lower lat. They can pull like normal traditional type row where the hand comes up by the rib cage and that gets mostly the mid-back traps and the lat as well. There's dead stop rows where the dumbbell starts and stops off the floor. There's a bajillion more, okay? So we'll save the rest of that. You can just look that up and also just YouTube dumbbell rows and just see all the variations that are out there. So This trainer had paired together as a superset that the person, their client, should do dumbbell 15-degree incline presses, supersetted with dumbbell one-arm rows, hand and knee on the bench. The conversation we got into was this might not be the best superset. And the reason why is a dumbbell row with a hand and knee on the bench is traditionally done with a flat bench. Now, can you do it on an inclined bench? Sure, the back rest would be up 15 degrees, like the press. But typically when you do a 15-degree incline press and you increase the back angle, you're also going to increase the seat angle so the person's wedged into the bench. So if the backrest of a bench goes up, typically the seat goes up. So if they wanted their person to do a hand and knee on the bench row, that's typically done with a flat bench. If you did it on a 15-degree inclined back angle, you would still need to put the seat down, so it's a flat angle for the knee support that you're asking them to have. So the problem was is they had them doing in one exercise, the chest press, with an inclined bench. But then they were asking them to do the dumbbell row on a flat bench. So either the person was going to have to change the bench angle between every single set. So they would do a set of the chest, then they'd have to adjust the bench back to flat. Do a set of the row. Then they'd have to adjust the bench back to incline. Do a set of the chest. Adjust the bench back to flat. Do a row. Adjust the bench back up to an incline. And it would just be ridiculous having to set that up over and over and over and over and over. And then the other alternative was the person wouldn't know any better, and they would feel really oddly positioned for the hand and knee on the bench row and just not really understand what was going on, not feel comfortable, and probably not get very good benefits, and maybe even question what in the world they were doing or their trainer was doing. So something as small of a detail as pairing together an inclined press with a flat knee, like a requirement of a row, that can cause issues. It either just makes your program inefficient because the person's wasting time and getting frustrated adjusting equipment back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, or they don't really know how to do it right. They feel inadequate and they kind of feel kind of confused, maybe odd. It doesn't have a good positive vibe to them, so they're less likely to do the workout, or they know that it's a stupid setup. They recognize that, and they recognize that the person gave them a stupid setup, and then they question what else maybe the person might be messing up, and it leads to the client maybe leaving that trainer. So all of these issues kind of it seems really small, okay, that you might have an inclined press with a flat bench, but that's actually really, really, flat bench row, by the way, that's actually really important. It's really significant because it can have larger impacts. So there are things we need to pay attention to in our programming much, much, much beyond just simple exercise selection. So, okay, does this exercise target the chest exactly the way I want? Yes or no? Does this back row target the back exactly the way I want? Yes or no? That's not enough. You have to then ask, okay, if I'm having this person do these back-to-back, do they pair well? Does this movement pair with that movement? And it can be like in regards to the setup. So if one thing requires an inclined bench, but one requires a flat bench, those are probably not a good pair. Also, recognizing what kind of equipment or what area they train in. Do they even have access to the two things you're asking them to do? So you might ask them to do a dumbbell press with maybe like lat pull downs, but the lat pull down machine is all the way across the gym. And they're in a busy commercial setting. There's no way they're going to be able to use a bench and dumbbells and have that be saved for them, quote unquote, while they run over to the other side of the gym and use a lat pull down. So they're either going to be the jerk that uses all the equipment and nobody can stand them, or they're going to constantly have stuff stolen from them because once they leave the lat pull down to go back over to do the dumbbell press, no one sees them around the lat pull down machine, so somebody's just going to jump on it and start using it. So not only do you have ease of setup, but also the ease of the superset in terms of proximity. So how close is the equipment to each other? So back when I used to teach at the university, I taught at university level classes for 7 years, taught exercise physiology and weight training and stuff. And one of the topics we would do in weight training classes was we would teach students how to write programming for fat loss goals, strength increase goals, or muscle size increase goals. And we also did nutrition programs as well. So that was one of the things we covered all the time was proximity of equipment. Because that was a mistake they would often make, is somebody would have their client or their person or pretend client doing two exercises, and either one of the exercises they didn't even have available in the damn gym, which was frustrating as hell because the students were sitting in the gym looking at the equipment. They could see what was there or not. So they were just picking something stupid offline but weren't really paying attention to what they were doing. So that frustrated me, as you can tell in my language. Or it was stuff that was all the way across the gym. Literally, it was from one wall of the gym to the other wall of the gym. And I'd look at them and I'd go, what the hell? Like, did you try this at all? So then they would kind of figure out that proximity was an issue. It was something to keep in mind. So then the timing of the exercises became important as well. So one aspect that relates to timing of exercises is intensity of exercises. So if I'm doing a one rep max as one of my exercises, and the other exercise is a 60-second exercise, those might not be great to pair because they're both going to make you ridiculously winded. So if I do something that's a true one rep max of like a squat, bench, or deadlift or something like that, you're going to be kind of out of breath right after that because there was a lot of hype that went into it, a lot of intensity. All your muscles of your body were contracting. Even though it was a short time frame, there was a high amount of workload being done. So the intensity was extremely high. But then if you pair them with something that's 60 seconds, maybe that's a low intensity, but it's still highly oxygen demanding. So what ends up happening is they're going to do the one rep max. Then they're like, let's just say for you did a one rep max on squats into bodyweight walking lunges for like 30 steps. Okay. So what would happen is they're going to get so winded from the squats that they're going to be lazy and kind of lose form focus during the lunges. They're going to be so damn winded from the lunges that it's going to take them forever to get back up for the squat. So you have to be careful about the type of intensities that you match together. So you can bring the squat to maybe a 3 to 5 rep max, and then maybe the dumbbells are just like a 12 to 16 steps, dumbbell walking lunges with 12 to 16 steps. So that might be something, sorry if the noise comes across to you guys, but that might be something that is better to pair because it's more matching, having them be more in the middle rather than on each extreme. Okay, so one of the things we can look at is podcast number 220. It is titled Muscle Intention versus Movement Intention, and it discusses the intention behind exercises. Whether you're doing an exercise slow and controlled to try to feel and target a specific muscle, or whether you're doing an exercise fast and explosive with momentum because it's the movement that you're looking to maximize. So think of like a barbell power clean versus a bicep curl. A power clean is very explosive. You're going to have a lot of momentum involved in that. There's a lot of muscles, just really explosive, aggressive lift. Whereas bicep curls, you should go slow and really feel the muscle stretching and squeezing. So having those movements and understanding how exercises can be done with either a muscle intention like a bicep curl or movement intention like a power clean, that's also something we would consider about whether we're putting something together that works well. So if you're putting together an explosive movement before an explosive movement, that can be very helpful in some times. So for example, box jumps before deadlifts, conventional deadlifts. Those are extremely helpful because the box jumps get somebody to feel explosive and it gets them to drive through the floor in a really explosive manner. Then they would walk over, they'd do a one, like say a single rep of a deadlift, conventional deadlift, and that explosivity of the box jumps would carry over to the deadlift. So having matching intensities, matching intentions, let's say it that way, a movement intention, an explosive intention in both movements, both exercises, helps a lot. So that's something very helpful. However, if you had somebody do really slow, controlled, like let's say machine leg curls, you want them to go real slow, like 5 second eccentric, maybe even a 3 second concentric, real slow, very mindful of their hamstrings. And then once you want them to go over and do a one rep maximal deadlift, those are kind of opposing intentions. So on one, the leg curls, you're having them kind of slow their heart rate down. They're becoming internally focused. Everything calms and focuses and narrows down to see if they can do that movement correct. And then you want them to go over to a deadlift, and they have to bring themselves out of that and be super aggressive, go crazy. I'm going to fire through this, da-da-da-da-da. And you're having them go back and forth, back and forth. Can that be done? Yes. And if you actually are doing it for the specific purpose of teaching them how to turn off and on their aggression, that's actually useful. But if you're doing it just because it happened to work out that way in your programming, recognize that you're going to wear that person out. They're going to have a much more nervous system and energy, mental energy fatigue from that workout because they have to constantly turn themselves from one intention to another. So there's a lot of mental fatigue that would come from that workout simply because two things are paired together with different intentions. So these are all small things that make big, big differences. So even looking at rest periods, so does the rest periods of what you're asking them to do match the intensities? So for example, often with most of my clients, the beginning of their workouts, we do movement preparation drills. Just some bodyweight stuff where they're getting some blood flow moving around. None of it is like maximally intensive. So they have very short rest periods because they don't really do anything that requires a large rest. Now they'll disagree. They're going to think they're working hard, but they're not. Okay. So in the sense of they're not getting majorly out of breath, they're just staying slightly out of breath the entire time. Okay. Whereas like after a one rep max, you should need a 2 to 3 or even longer minute rest. Especially if somebody's super strong, they might need 5, 6, 7, 8 minute rest. Okay? So if you have somebody squatting 2.5, 3 times their body weight, they might need a 5 to 8 minute rest between squats. Okay? But if you pair that heavy squat with something like walking lunges and you tell them only take 1 minute rest, there's no chance in hell they're going to do that. There's no way they can do a heavy squat, go all their lunges, and then in 1 minute be ready to get back under the bar for squatting. Ain't gonna happen. Okay? So we have to be aware of that. There's also differences in strength levels per client. So if I know somebody can squat 2 times their body weight, their rest periods are different than somebody who struggles to squat only their body weight. So knowing these things matters a lot. Small differences matter. Okay? So there's even collateral damage concerns. So we've talked about this in an old podcast. So I'm going to look up the number right now for you guys. So I didn't have it ahead of time. Apologize for that. But the podcast number is 82, titled Collateral Damage Concerns. And what that is in regards to is if I have somebody doing, say, a barbell bent over row into a dumbbell row, both of those require lower back strength. So they might not be good to have back-to-back because the lower back is going to fatigue probably before the upper back and the lats do. So you have to make sure that you're what is involved in the movement other than just the working muscle. You have to make sure that those actually match correctly. So as an example of this, I used this point the other day with a client, and it was on purpose. I was doubling up something that didn't want to be doubled up. So we had trained legs the day before, and I wanted them to kind of get a little extra touch in their legs, get some blood flow into their legs to help with recovery, and just kind of help kind of toughen them up a little bit or test them and see how they were doing in terms of me challenging them. So I paired it with dumbbell bent over rows, dual bent over rows, and I made them tap the floor with the dumbbells every rep. So they had to be in a pretty squatted position in order to do that. And their legs were already sore and fired up from the day before. So when they got into position, they said, holy freaking crap, my legs can't barely hold this position. And I said, yeah, I know. See if you can do it anyhow. So I wanted to see if we could push a little bit further into damage and stress on the legs to get faster response. So it wasn't technically a leg exercise, but it absolutely used their legs. So you have to consider this when you write exercises, is there's the target muscle, but what are the other muscles that are being used? Are you using lower back? Are you using forearms? Are you using biceps? So if somebody does like 2 types of rows back to back, that can actually tire out your forearms and your biceps more than it tires out your upper back. So you're better off pairing it, for example, pull-ups and pull-downs, okay, with rows. So do a vertical back movement paired with a horizontal back movement. That tends to be better pairing than back-to-back verticals or back-to-back horizontal. So it allows a little bit of a change of position to reduce some of the collateral damage issues, the collateral like being those side muscles that you don't really want to target, but they are involved. So This is stuff that is extremely, extremely important when you're writing programming. Don't look at just what does the exercise do and does it do what I want it to do. Look at the exercises around it. Look at the sequence of the workout. Think about the equipment. Is it easy to set it up or will it take really long time to set it up? Do the things you want them to do together even freaking match? Do they even have the equipment available? Oh, for love of God. So I've talked with trainers before and they'll write programs for people that are template bullshit. And they'll give it to a client, and that client doesn't even have a piece of equipment available to them. They'll go to a gym, and their program asks for a seated hamstring curl, and the gym doesn't even have one. That's being pretty damn lazy as a trainer, especially if the client thinks they're signing up for a program that's personalized. If they know they bought a template, and they know that the workout is general, then that's on them. But if you are writing something for a client, you need to know what equipment they have available. So I can't tell you the amount of times where I've asked clients what gyms they train to. I've looked up the gym online, or I've asked them to send me pictures or send videos so I actually know what equipment there is so we can actually write the best workouts. Sometimes they have really cool equipment available. Sometimes they don't have any really good equipment available. And we actually work around equipment because what they have is shit. So I don't even want to put them on it because it's not a good machine. So you need to know what equipment is available to your clients if you're going to write their programs. So this stuff seems like it's very small, but these are actually largely impactful on the quality of your programming. It's going to impact the quality of the liftee's experience. So your client's experience is going to matter, okay? It's going to differ if you don't pay attention to these small details. So you want them to have the better enjoyment of their workout. So if the small details are taken care of, they're going to enjoy the workouts more. The workouts are going to feel kind of less joint annoyances. It's going to be easier set up. They're going to feel more confident with what they're doing. And they're actually going to get better results due to the efficiency of the training. So all of these things matter because they help ensure long-term retention of clients. Not only results, but even keeping the client around for a long time. So I have some clients I've had for years, like 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years. Because I'm able to write programming that they actually enjoy, programming that evolves and develops with them, and it stays personalized at all times. So no matter where they move to, I make sure the equipment that we're asking them to use is available to them. So I make sure that the style of the training matches their goals and their lifestyle. So if I have somebody who got, like they just moved and they got a new job, I'm probably not going to ask them to do highly technical sessions that take an hour and a half, 2 hours. I'm going to say, here's some stuff that's basic, quick, easy, fast setups, but we're going to use really just fun set techniques that are easy to learn, but they'll add the intensity we need to your training, and we're going to keep your training at maybe 40 minutes to 60 minutes at most, so that we can get home, take care of what you need to take care of, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. So writing programming for new parents, sometimes you have to write the programs, workouts might only take 20, 30 minutes, but what happens if they have a whole day to themselves? Maybe you'll make the workouts to where they come in sections of 20 minutes. Maybe one day they can do only one section. Maybe one day they can do two or three. So they can put together a 40 or 60-minute workout when they have the time. So how can you personalize the programming specific to your client? That's the thing you want to pay attention to. Not only just are the exercises targeting what I want them to target. Are the rep ranges correct for the results I want? Look beyond that stuff. Look to the small details. The small details matter. Okay? So, the idea of this podcast was to raise your awareness to these things, and maybe you can take a look at them and see if there's anything you can do to improve your program towards these small details. Okay? If you need any help, shoot us an email or email us brutalirongym@gmail.com. Like I said, we help with consultations, we help with ghostwriting, we help with programming for your goals, and then typically what that helps is there's educational support to it, so that way you can learn from your training to better apply it to your own clients. Okay? So whatever you would need as trainers, we're always here to help. We love it. That's why we make these podcasts. The more trainers we help, the more long-term overall people we help. So if we help one trainer and they have 20 clients, we've technically helped 21 people. So we love, love, love collecting people that we help. That's what our goal is. Okay? So reach out if you need anything. The email is brutalirongym@gmail.com. And thank you very, very much for listening to the podcast. We appreciate your support. Cool. If you like the podcast, please share it with family and friends. The more people we help, the happier the world will be. Also, if you like this information, you can find more from us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at Brutal Iron Gym. And if you have any questions, feedback, or suggestions, we'd love to hear from you. The podcast is for you, so we want to know what you want to learn about. You can tell us at our email at brutalirongym@gmail.com. As always, I hope this was helpful, and thank you for listening. And thank you for watching.